Flexible during this season of change, and we thank you for all of the team who has put this together. Thank you for your hard work and your diligence. If you're a guest and you're watching live, and maybe you live in the community or near First Baptist Prosper, there in the comment section you'll see a connection card. We want to invite you to connect with us. Maybe you have a specific prayer request or you'd like to know more about First Baptist Prosper. Feel free to click on that link and fill out that information. Or maybe you want to just send us a private message. We would be honored if you would do so. To start our worship this morning, I'm reminded of Psalm 34 as we think about this transition in all of our lives, and especially during this coronavirus. I'm reminded of Psalm 34, verse 17 through 19. The psalmist writes, "When the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears and delivers them out of all of their troubles. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all." Maybe you feel crushed this morning. Maybe this pandemic is weighing heavily on you mentally, physically, emotionally, financially, and even spiritually. We just want to pause right now and give our honor to the Father, to the Creator of this vast universe, the one who gives us breath. Let's pray right now, especially for those who have been affected deeply by COVID-19. Would you pause and pray with me as we continue in worship? Father, we recognize your supreme goodness. Lord, these are trying days, but not unknown or uncommon throughout history, even through your church. For she has seen much worse. And Lord, right now, for our guests who are watching and listening online, Lord, would you just bring a sense of peace, a sense of comfort, a sense of provision, especially those locally, nationally, and globally who have been devastated by this virus. And maybe not just the virus, but other circumstances. Lord, somebody needs a word from you. Somebody needs comfort. Countless need healing, Father. Lord, as we transition in this worship hour, Lord, as we continue singing, would your Spirit pour out upon us, that you would have your way with us, Father. We are careful to give you the honor and glory that you so deserve. And we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Oh,
Church, if you have your copy of God's Word or your device, let me invite you to turn to the minor prophet book of Habakkuk as we conclude this mini series in this short yet powerful book consisting of only three chapters, 56 verses. I've titled this series, When It Doesn't Make Sense. And some would argue whether it's fitting that this would be my last sermon with you, my last message as the interim pastor here at First Baptist Prosper. And let me just thank you to our church family. Thank you for really this incredible opportunity. It's been an honor for for me and my family to serve with you and worship with you these last 12 months. Thank you for that. When it doesn't make sense, if you remember from last week, and I'll spend just a couple of moments reminding us from last week's message, I spent a few moments just really overlooking chapters 1 and 2. But if you remember from last week, Habakkuk's name in Hebrew literally means to embrace. Last week, chapters 1 and 2, we discovered this dialogue, or better stated, an argument between Habakkuk and God. Well, really, it was just an argument from Habakkuk. Two complaints from Habakkuk and two answers from God. The first set of complaints, Habakkuk witnessed firsthand injustice and idolatry, and we saw that later on in chapter 2 through the five woes. But this injustice and idolatry that was found in Judah, Israel's southern kingdom, and he wanted or expected God to act, especially an act of justice. But God told Habakkuk, if you remember, he's aware of the current condition of the nation of Israel. He even says there, look at the nations and see, wonder and be astounded. He goes on to say, for I am doing a work. As a matter of fact, you wouldn't even begin to understand if I gave you those answers. That reminds me of Job chapter 38 and 39, where God is ultimately putting Job in his rightful place. Where were you, Job, when I created the heavens and the earth? Can you do this, Job? Can you do that? You see, God was going to use an evil and cruel Babylon to bring about judgment on Judah. Of course, Habakkuk doesn't naturally like it. Which leads us to the second set of complaints and answers from last week's message. Habakkuk, God, you who are pure, how can you sit idly by and do nothing to Judah? And even worse, how can you use a prideful and evil Babylon, this nation who instills fear across our land? How can you use them to do your work? And then if you remember, God answers. Habakkuk, write the vision there at the beginning, end of chapter 1, beginning of chapter 2. Habakkuk, write the vision, make it plain. That vision, the revelation, the judgment awaits at its appointed time. It's important that I remind you that Habakkuk took place some 600 years before Christ. And this is important to history because all of history, not just through biblical history, speaks to this. So even though the destruction didn't happen, the answers didn't happen when and how Habakkuk desired, some 10 to 20 years later in 586 BC, Judah falls. And some 60 to 65 years later in 539 BC, history tells us that Babylon falls. So God was intentional about his business. And we can't help but wonder how frustrated Habakkuk must have been through these difficult times. We can't help but imagine how furious Habakkuk must have been when God didn't answer his prayer. But before we move on, there were two important statements, one by God in verse 4 of chapter 2, and one by Habakkuk in verse 20 of chapter 2. Let me remind you there, if you're looking along, Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4, the righteous shall live by faith. This is the very essence of the gospel that we find Paul and the apostles quoting. Romans chapter 1, verse 17, Galatians chapter 3, verse 11, Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 8, for by faith you're saved, by grace alone. And even found in Hebrews chapter 10, verses 37 through 39. And if time permits, I'll leave us this morning with that passage. But there was also an important statement by Habakkuk. So God makes this statement in verse 4, the righteous shall live by faith. And then down to close out chapter 2, Habakkuk. says the Lord is in his temple, literally on his throne. Let the earth keep silent. This reminds me of that verse, Psalm 46, verse 10. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations, and in the earth I will be exalted. Habakkuk begins to have a change of heart. You see, Habakkuk desperately desires revival within his own people, within Judah, within Israel. He desperately desires revival for his nation. But don't miss this, church. It's subtle. What's happening here is a revival begins to take place in his own heart. I'm reminded of the quote by Thomas A. Kempis. We take others to task for small mistakes and overlook greater ones in and of ourselves. Not to downplay the importance of Habakkuk's message, this God-inspired prophet that we know little about. But you see what's happening here. He wishes judgment on those people, much like we mentioned last week with Jonah and the Ninevites. But yet, when God works through us to reach people, we see that God ultimately works in us. You see, it's the preacher, it's the minister, it's the church leader that he seeks to desire a change, a radical change in their hearts and ultimately in their lives as they are about their mission of spreading the gospel, sharing the good news. And I realize the difficulty that we live in today. Much of the news we hear is not good. But rest assured, church, rest assured that the gospel is our only hope. It is our only assurance. It is our only strength. Which leads me to chapter 3. These 19 verses, I'll really ping with two major points. Two major points that can be found in verses 1 through 16, Habakkuk's reverence for God, and then verses 17 through 19, Habakkuk's confidence in God. Don't miss this. His reverence and his confidence. Look at the first two verses with me. A prayer of Habakkuk, the prophet, according to Shigionith, literally a song, an instrument. So not only is this a prayer, most scholars would lead us to believe that this is a song, that instruments are being used. And then verse 2, O Lord, I have heard the report of you and your work, O Lord, do I fear. So this fear is not a trembling fear, but it's a fear in awe. It's a fear of respect and reverence. And look at this, the second part of verse 2. In the midst of the years, revive it. So he's calling for revival. In the midst of the years, make it known. And in wrath, remember mercy. So the first thing we see here under Habakkuk's reverence for God is he's talking to God, right? He's acknowledging God. A prayer, a song. And he's heard this report, this history, these historical stories that are coming to his mind that he had learned as a little boy. He had heard of his works, his marvelous and salvific acts through Exodus and the Red Sea. Woven from Genesis to Revelation, we see these marvelous works of God. And then he says, revive us. He knew what was needed. It doesn't take you long to be around many in the church in America. Specifically for those who pay attention to the political climate and theological climate in our world. Many church leaders desire for revival in America, don't they? This is exactly what Habakkuk is wishing upon his people. But did you catch that? He says, although you will bring judgment, as sin goes unpunished, I beg of you mercy. Would you act in mercy? Would you be slow to anger, God? So in Habakkuk's reverence to God, he's talking to God. And then verses 3 through 7, he transitioned. Now he's talking about God to others. He's talking about God to others. Look at verses 3 through 7 with me, church. God came from Teman or Teman, literally southern Edom. We find this in Deuteronomy chapter 32 and 33, and the Holy One from the Mount, from Mount Paran, literally His glory. And how we know it's a song is it ends in this word Selah, this pause for reflection, most historians tell us. His splendor covered the heavens, and the earth was full of His praise. His brightness was like the light, rays flashed from His hand, and there He veiled His power. Before Him went pestilence, and plague followed at His heels. He stood and measured the earth. He looked and shook the nations. Then the eternal mountains were scattered. The everlasting hills sank low. His were the everlasting ways. I saw the tents of Cushan in affliction. The curtains of the land of Midian did tremble. So now he's talking about God to others. He's literally being an evangelist. He's telling of His majesty. He's telling of His might and His good works. Listed this way in verses 3 through 7, we see Him talking about His splendor. He's speaking about His brightness in verse 4. As one preacher said, too awesome to view, too powerful to miss. And I don't want you to miss this in verse 5. Before Him went pestilence, which literally signifies judgment, and plagues followed at His heels. So not only His splendor and His brightness, but His command. The imagery in verse 5 for me is this picture of you at home, of me when we walk our dogs. I don't know about your dog, but maybe your dog is well-behaved and well-trained. But most dog training experts will tell you that when you train a dog to walk, right, to walk on a leash, ideally that dog is to walk to your side or right there at your heel, at your command, at your beck and call, to sit, to stand, to fetch, to go, to stop. Do you see this, church? Before Him went pestilence, and plagues followed at His heels. Listen, I'm reminded throughout history, from the mid-1300s to the 1700s, the bubonic plague, the black plague that lasted 400 years, that had wiped out nearly a third of all humanity. And what about 1918 through 1919? The Spanish flu, 50 million. Lost their lives. And then, of course, today, not knowing that we would be faced with this pandemic, COVID-19. I'm not suggesting to you that COVID-19 is judgment upon His creation, although it is a result of the fall of humanity that we see through the creation narrative found in Genesis. But what I am suggesting to you is not only His splendor and His brightness, but His command is this, is that COVID-19 or any other disease that ravages our bodies and our minds moves not without His direction, or at least His knowledge. To go, to stop, to sit, to stand. And it's vital for us to find some comfort and solitude. These are difficult days, to say the least. But then Habakkuk goes on in verse 6. He said, He stood and measured the earth. He looked and shook the nations. Do you have this imagery in your head playing out? Then the eternal mountains were scattered. The everlasting hills sank low. His were the everlasting ways. So now Habakkuk is speaking not only of His splendor, His brightness, His command, but now he's speaking of God Almighty's power. And then in verse 7, we learn of His wrath. The tents of Cushan. So these nations, right, in affliction. The curtains of the land of Midian did tremble. So it's important that we understand history here that Cushan and Midian were nations that stood in opposition to their Creator, to God Almighty. So, of course, he enacts wrath. He enacts anger. And he's ultimately going to enact justice on them and judgment. And now we transition again in verses 8 through 15. So not only is Habakkuk's reverence, he's talking to God, he's talking about God to others. And in verses 8 through 15, he's talking to God again. But it's reversed here, starting with wrath in verse 8. Was your wrath against the rivers? I mean, a silly question, Habakkuk. Are you angry at the rivers? Was your anger against the seas, your creation? When you rode on your horses, on your chariot of salvation, you stripped the sheath from your bow, calling for many arrows, Selah. So the writer here, Habakkuk, is wanting us to pause and reflect. And the mountains saw you and withered. The raging waters swept on, verse 10. The deep gave forth its voice. It lifted its hand on high. The sun and moon stood still in their place at the light of your arrows as they sped. Of course they did. They're his creation. At the flash of your glittering spear, you marched through the earth in fury. You threshed the nations in anger. You went out for the salvation of your people, for the salvation of your anointed. You crushed the head of the house of the wicked, laying him bare from thigh to neck. Selah. Pause and reflect, church. In verse 14 and 15, you pierced with his own arrow the heads of his warriors, who came like a whirlwind to scatter me, rejoicing as if to devour the poor in secret. You trampled the sea with your horses, the surging of mighty waters. So let me just reverse verses 3 through 7 for you. So Habakkuk is now expressing God's description to himself, right? He's speaking of his wrath, of his power, of his command, of his salvation in verse 13, and of his splendor. And then in verse 16, Habakkuk, like many of us, talks to himself. Look at verse 16. I hear and my body trembles. My lips quiver at the sound. Rottenness enters into my bones. My legs tremble beneath me. Yet I will quietly wait for the day of trouble. So we see this heart transformation right before our eyes. Yet I will quietly wait for the day of trouble to come upon people who invade us. Habakkuk's talking to self. But I don't want us to miss this in verses 1 through 16. This heart transformation, this revival that's taken place in Habakkuk's own heart and in his own life, he is not only speaking to God, but he is speaking about him. And you, his creation, for those who have found faith in Jesus Christ, you, this is our mandate to speak of his splendor, to speak of his majesty, to speak of his glory, to speak of his wrath, and to speak of his power. And maybe like Habakkuk, this heart change can happen for you and me. I don't know about you, but I always find myself in this constant struggle, this constant wrestling between flesh and spirit that we see Paul talking about right in the book of Romans. This is exactly what's happening for Habakkuk. And maybe you, right there where you are, in the midst of our current circumstances in America and all over the world, you're angry at God. You are wanting answers from God. In the midst of the quietness and stillness of your schedule, you forget to speak about God. And yet this is what Habakkuk's pointing us to, church. This is exactly where he's pointing us to, that those of us who claim Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, to constantly speak about him in our homes, in our hearts. This is the very mandate for all who call on Jesus. So, verses 1 through 16, we learn of Habakkuk's reverence for God. And then lastly, the second point, we see Habakkuk's confidence in God. this incredible transformation in this prophet's life that would maybe resonate for some of us today. Look at verses 17 through 19. Though the fig tree should not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail, and the fields yield no food, the flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls. So even when the land and livestock is not producing food, or for many finances, for Judah, right, and possibly even Habakkuk, not producing food and finances for the people, due to the Babylonian invasion that we spoke of earlier, the destruction that was coming, what Habakkuk is saying is, I have no food. I have no finances. And that would lead me to lead and believe that I find my faith dwindling. Although the future looks bleak, the future is scarce, the future is unknown, look what happens here. In verse 18, although these are my present circumstances, although this is my situation, look at verse 18, yet I will rejoice in the Lord, I will take joy in the God of my salvation. I will rejoice in the Lord, even though there's no sustenance to my current situation. There's no provision. I will rejoice in the Lord. This is exactly what the Apostle Paul talks about in Philippians 3:14 when he says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That passage has nothing to do with superpowers other than contentment, this quiet contentedness that I mentioned last week. Even though there's no sustenance, I will rejoice in the Lord. Even though there is no provision, I will take joy in Christ. Why? Look at verse 19. God, the Lord, is my strength. He makes my feet like the deer's. He makes me tread on my high places. Here's why. He says the source of his strength, the source of his provision is God, the Lord. God of his salvation. So the question is this morning is regardless of what's happening around us, and yes, I know it's easier for me to say this than live this, but is he the source of your strength? And he uses this incredible imagery, my feet are like the deer's. The Message Bible translates that or paraphrases that I run like the deer, agile and free. I tread on my high places, he says in verse 19. The Message translates that or paraphrases that king of the mountain, not in a prideful sense, but in an encouraging sense. So verses 17 through 19, we see destruction leads to celebration. I like what Chuck Smith, founder of Calvary Chapel, says about verses 18 through 19. He says, literally, this is dancing faith. So the question this morning for me and for you is, can you dance in faith through difficult days? I had no idea how Habakkuk would lead us in these days. But I want to leave you, church, with just a couple of closing thoughts, not really from Alex, but from Scripture itself. Turn to Matthew chapter 6 and verse 25 with me. Matthew chapter 6, and then I'll draw your attention to Hebrews 10. Matthew chapter 6, verses 25 through 34. So we find Jesus in the beginning of his ministry, preaching chapters 5 through 7, this Sermon on the Mount, this revolutionary teaching that the Father was embraced in. And we find, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, verse 25 of Matthew 6. Therefore I tell you, church, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? He goes on to say, look at the birds, and even listen to the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them daily. Are you not of more value than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing, church? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon, in all of his glory, was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. When you take your trip to the grocery store, and you can't find what you need for basic necessities in your home, draw your attention to Matthew 6. Your heavenly Father knows what you need. And he says this in verse 33, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. It's easy for you to say, Jesus. That's easy for you to say to these first century followers, these Jews who were listening. But yet I'm reminded of his sacrifice on Calvary 2,000 years ago. And even before that, in the Garden of Gethsemane, where he pleaded with the Father to remove this chalice, remove this cup from me. The tension and the stress and the agony was so great on him. He sweat blood. But yet, he went from human to heavenly, right? He says, not my will be done, but your will, Father. And then, Hebrews 10. This is important for us. Hebrews chapter 10, starting in verse 32. We see this still resonating with the righteous shall live by faith. The author of Hebrews says in verse 32, but recall the former days when after you were enlightened, you endured a hard struggle with suffering, sometimes being publicly exposed to reproach and affliction. By the way, church, if the world has not uncovered or seen what we believe about the Bible and how we follow our Lord and Savior, they will soon. But I submit to you, they're already doing it, how we respond to difficult days. Verse 33, sometimes being publicly exposed to reproach and affliction, and sometimes being partners with those so treated. For you had compassion on those in prison, and you joyfully accepted the plundering of your property. My property was destroyed. I accepted it, since you knew that you yourselves had a better possession and an abiding one. Therefore, do not throw away your confidence, church family. Do not throw away your confidence, which has a great reward. For you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what is promised. And yet a little while, and the coming one will come and will not delay. But my righteous one shall live by faith. We saw that in Habakkuk 2:4. You remember? Watch this. And if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure. Verse 39. But we are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who have faith and preserve their souls. Did you catch that? Keep the confidence. Stay in the race, the endurance. You need this. We know. And never, like before, have we seen a need for you to press in to the Father, but even his church body. Although we're distant and we can't worship together, now more than ever, is when you need a church family. But he says, we are not those who shrink back and are destroyed. I absolutely love this. Like an old football coach. Tough times don't last, but tough people do, right? As cheesy as that sounds, that's what the author of Hebrews is saying. Stay in the fight. Stay the course. Endure to the end. Do not shrink back. So in closing, when it doesn't make sense, here's what we take from this. And it's really found in my 2 points I shared with you. Here's what we take from the lessons of Habakkuk. Have complete reverence for God. Can you honestly say that today? Do you have complete reverence in the creator of the universe, where all disease and death are at his heels, listening for his very command? Secondly, have total confidence in God. Even though we don't know who holds the future, we do know who holds the future. We don't know the future, right? We don't know what's going to happen. But we know who has the future in his hands. Give your fear to Christ. Give your doubt to the Father. Give your life in humble submission to King Jesus. I'm reminded of this quote from Corrie Ten Boom. You can never learn that Christ is all you need until Christ is all you have. Reverence and confidence. May it be said of us, regardless of what the future holds, in this new transition for you, as we still seek to call a pastor, but as we call in and the Lord ushers in a new interim, revere the Father, have confidence in God. That's our prayer. That's our mandate. As we go about this world that has lost all hope, sharing the good news of Jesus, every head bowed and every eye closed, even on your couch or in your bed. Maybe you're listening in and you're watching, and you could honestly say, Alex, this coronavirus has me terrified. My faith has diminished. The unknown has me scared. Maybe you know somebody who has been touched by this disease. Maybe it's not COVID-19. Maybe it's other things. Maybe, like for many, we've experienced job loss. We all can relate to the stock market losing some 30 points. Maybe you have lost all hope. But like Habakkuk, you're in desperate need of a revival in your own life, in your own heart. Before you can have revival, let me ask those who are listening and watching. If you were to take your last breath today, could you honestly say you know where you would spend eternity? If you've been on social media at all, you've seen where nations all over the world who have never cried out to Jesus are now crying out to him. I read this morning where Jesus is trending on Twitter. You say, what does that even mean? What it means is people are searching. Maybe you are searching right there where you are. Look, it goes like this. If you've never given your life to Jesus, if you've never confessed your sins, acknowledged that he is the Savior, that he took the sins of all humanity on an old rugged cross, died the death we deserve, and rose again, that all those who place their faith in Him would have eternal life. If you've never given your life to Him, right there where you are, in the living room, in your bedroom, in your office, from your car, would you surrender to Him today? You say, Alex, maybe I am a Christian, but I'm scared. I get it. I'm scared too. Would you place your reverence and confidence in God Almighty? Maybe you're listening and watching and you have a specific prayer need. You'd like to send us a message. Or maybe this morning, right where you are, you've prayed to receive Christ as your Savior. In need of revival. Would you send us a message just so we can acknowledge that, but even reach out to you? We can put resources in your hand to help you through life's journey. Lord, we love you now. Have your way with us. In Christ's name. Amen.
excited that you joined us today for this live stream. It is a very special Sunday for us because it is our interim pastor, Alex Gonzalez, last Sunday serving as our interim pastor. Alex, would you please go ahead and come up here for me, man? And I don't know if you guys know how much of a blessing this man has been, but I tell you what, when we called him to come in, we asked him, hey, could you come and preach on Sundays? And it ended up with him devoting his life, his family, his energy, his sleep even. Waking up in the morning, posting on our social media page, praying over our church family. If you haven't loved and appreciated Alex Gonzalez enough, you need to today. Drop a comment in the comment section. Put a like. Go to his Facebook page. Share your love for him, because this man, I tell you, this man is doing things for the kingdom of God. And so we have a few gifts for you today, Alex. First and foremost, for your beautiful wife, Tabitha. There's a flowers for her. Of course, we couldn't do everything like we originally planned due to everything going on. But those flowers are for Tabitha. You guys, we love Tabitha. We love Avery. We love Cody. And we thank you guys so much as a family for devoting yourselves to our church. Secondly, in here was a letter and two gift cards. One to Saw Grace Steakhouse, which Alex loves some steak, if you don't know. And number two to Bahama Bucks, because Alex has a crazy affinity for snow cones. So,
no, frozen lemonade.
Frozen lemonade, I'm sorry. Frozen lemonade. So,
Thank you, church.
Third of all, probably the best gift you could get right now, your own Ghost Prosper hand sanitizer bottle right here. I mean, hot commodity right now. So
$10,000.
Well, hey, Alex, we love you, brother. And I'm going to invite Will Heath up. If you don't know, Will Heath is our next interim pastor. He will be preaching next Sunday. And we're looking forward to his leadership, his preaching, and what God is going to do through him. But we thought we'd have a really cool moment here where Will can pray over Alex, sending Alex off to rest in this new season. And then Alex can pray over Will, sending him into a season of leadership here at Post Baptist Gospel. And so, Will, would you lift Alex up in a word of prayer?
Yeah.
And Alex, thank you, brother.
Church, if you would, just symbolically, if you just want to extend your hand out and join me in virtually laying hands on Alex and Tabitha. And God, we're so thankful for you. This is catching the world off guard, but it's not catching you off guard. Lord, we thank you for this, such a time as this, as you gave Alex the opportunity to lead over this past year. God, you were working through him. And Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to follow his leadership and follow the work that he's been doing here as we anticipate calling him pastor at some point in the future. Lord, I just thank you for his giftedness. I thank you for his leadership. I thank you for his love for the church. But more importantly, God, I thank you for him being a pace setter for how much he just loves you. As a pastor, Lord, he is such a phenomenal pastor. And Lord, we will be grateful for a long time for his leadership that he's given to us as a church. Amen.
Lord, I thank you for my brother Will. I had no idea what you had in store when our paths crossed late last summer. Lord, I thank you for this sweet transition. As we have talked much about behind closed doors, that First Baptist Prosper is going to rewrite the book where previous interim sticks around, previous pastor has been sticking around, Lord. We thank you for that time, those families that are represented. And now, Lord, this fourth quarter, this fourth leg of the race, this final stretch, Lord, as you continue to prepare the hearts of the people, that you would prepare the heart of our next pastor and his family as we hand this mantle off to Will. Lord, we pray for him We pray for his family, his precious family, those girls, his wife. Lord, for we know the work that you've called pastors to, and it is great. Give them a renewed sense of energy and enthusiasm and wisdom as they navigate these trying times. That one day we will look back and we'll say, oh Lord, that's what you were doing. However long you allow us to have, Will Heath, Lord, I pray that you would work wonderfully, majestically through his life and his leadership and the rest of the staff. Father, we pray blessings over them now. And we are careful through all of this to acknowledge that you alone are worthy of that honor and glory. For we get none of the credit. It is only you. It is only you, Father. We love you. Thank you. In Jesus' name.
Jokes family, we love you guys. We thank you so much for tuning in for this special day of worship. If you haven't already, join us for our Facebook Live devotions every day, Monday through Friday. And then tune in again next Sunday as Will Heath, our new interim pastor, brings us the word of God. We love you. Go and be the church to a mill that desperately needs it. God bless.